So before I speak about specific initiatives, I would like to say a few words on my view and the Novartis view in general about diversity and inclusion. Because I really think that diversity, creating a diverse workforce, and then making sure you really leverage that diversity, is a key driver of business success. And I emphasize the including part, not only diversity part, because in my view, it's potentially easier to create a diverse workforce in terms of recruitment, promotion. The real hard part is to make sure that you really use that diversity. It's so much easier to have 5 people who all think alike. You have a very quick conclusion to your meeting. There you go. It's much more challenging, much more fun, but also much more challenging to have a much broader audience, a much broader team with different perspectives, different experiences, and then come up with a better solution. But it's a challenge. So I think the inclusion part should always be emphasized. Coming to specific initiatives. So first of all, we have a constant stream at Novartis of education and training of our associates on this theme of diversity and inclusion. For example, we recently had a speaker for the whole organization on generational diversity and the differences in perceptions between, you know, 30-year-olds and 60-year-olds and everything in between. And that is just an example of something we do, education training as development for our people. Then 2 specific examples, 1 internally and 1 externally. Internal example, we have created on top of a normal home working policy that we have. We looked further into this whole topic of work-life balance. And we created what we call a hybrid working system. And what that means is that people work a normal full-time job, but in the summer holiday, they have an additional month of free time. And this is very much appreciated by especially females in the organization. So we have in total 16% of our workforce working in this system, and 90% of that 16%, so the vast majority, are women who want to be with their children in the summer holiday. So that's an internal example of something that really works very well. Externally, we have created about 1.5 year ago a magazine specifically targeted to female doctors. So as a pharma company, of course, our main target audience customers are doctors. And we noticed from talking to those female doctors that they have different needs than their male colleagues. They like to be communicated to, receive information from us in a different way. So based on their needs, we created this magazine. It's now distributed to 9,000 female doctors on a quarterly basis. And that magazine has 3 themes. First of all, scientific information. Of course, they are doctors, so they want to receive scientific information, and we do that in a peer-to-peer way, so other females explaining science to them. Second part is some lifestyle, and a third part is very much on gender equality, on differences between genders, on diversity and inclusion. And it's a magazine that that is highly appreciated by that audience. A couple of things. First of all, I'm a very results-driven person, and I really believe that diversity creates better business results. So that's number one. Number two, I see in general, you always speak about averages when you talk about female-male differences, that female leaders have a more collaborative, a more open, a more empowering attitude. And I really think that this is healthy as a balance in the company. And maybe really more personal, I've had a lot of chances and opportunities myself in my career. So I really feel the responsibility now that I'm in a leadership position to pay this forward and help other talented females to have the same opportunities that I've had. So I've been at the receiving end of quite a few Novartis programs on female executive leadership trainings. And part of those trainings were also, how do you now pay this forward? You've received a certain training, what do you do with it towards other talented females? So on the basis of that, I'm mentoring several talented females. I've also had several discussion groups with more talented females lower in the organization to share my experiences in my career, also for them to discuss their hurdles, their perceptions, their issues. That's one thing. The second one, potentially most impactful currently, is a very active role modeling in the organization. I am a mother of 2 young children. So I want to be, first of all, bringing them to school in the morning. And secondly, I want to be home between 6 and 8:30 and be there for them. So I'm here in the office between 9 and at 5:30 I leave, and that's not so normal for the CEO. So I do that very consistently, and I think I create a clear example and allow other people to also organize their work life as they want to. You know, for me, it's much easier to switch on the computer again at 8:30 and work then. I don't stay here till 7. I never do, and that creates a big example, I think, in the whole company. Another way of let's say role modeling is through the magazine that we just discussed. So this Feel Better magazine, where I've really emphasize that we should also include a diversity discussion in that magazine, because it is a female doctor magazine, and we do that. I also have done interviews in that magazine myself, and we invite other female role models to do the same. Yeah, there was some resistance against this hybrid working system, because we had from the business leaders some fears that, you know, if a lot of people would take a long holiday over the summer, this would impact the business continuity. So we've challenged them back, and I continue to do that because the resistance keeps on coming, to say, you know, there's a lot of new technology, be creative, make sure that you bridge this, because this is something that we do want to keep offering to our associates. So that's one very particular resistance. The other one is more, I don't know if you want to call it resistance, but I think that lots of females create obstacles in their own head, basically. It's all about perception. When I do these discussions with talented females in the organization, I often hear that they think that you cannot do a certain level job with a certain work-life balance. And I really try to remove those perceptions, because that is what's holding people back, and it's really a shame. So in short, I think it would be a bad business decision not to create a diverse workforce and really make use of that diversity. That's the short version. If you kind of turn it around, I come back to what I said in the beginning. Diversity creates a lot more innovation, creates a lot more success. And even more importantly, potentially, if you allow people to be themselves, they are much happier and you get the best from them. So that is, to me, the key thing: business success and, you know, a happy workforce.